she will share with us about all the information that
you are watching. DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills. Boy, that song just grows on you, or that tune. Hello, my name is Mike Fraga, and we are near completion of a journey that has taken us to an appreciation of the immigrant experience here in the United States. This is SBS 318, Cultural Pluralism, Immigration, and Citizenship. Now, people watching this presentation on cable, please use the 800 number that will be listed below and call to contribute to an important discourse on the immigrant experience. And students, please chat with me on the website provided so that you can interact with me as we try to appreciate the immigration restriction legislation. Now, we have learned in this course that the U.S. federal government supports both corporate and business needs for inexpensive workers and high profits. And since its inception, the United States has maintained groups of rightless workers. This course has viewed the historical experiences of all of the different directions of humanity, from red beans to brown beans to black beans to white beans to yellow beans. We have studied the experience of the immigrant as slaves, as colonial subjects, as racial and ethnic minorities, and then undocumented workers. And the resounding theme throughout the study so far is that the federal government insures people without rights for business. The United States practices what is known as exclusionary citizenship, and please get to know it. It began with indentured servants. Then it moved to slavery. It is now called undocumented immigration. It is a contracted form of labor. We have witnessed disenfranchisement and dispossession of the immigrant worker sprinkled with white racism. The fear of the other, the fear of the not me, of the stranger at the gate, the fear of the immigrants translates into policy that prevents people from achieving social justice, that prevents people from achieving equality. See, whites and Europeans were extended open immigration. They came as voluntary immigrants. Meanwhile, restricted immigration was created for everyone else. Africans faced enslavement or endured enslavement. Asians experienced exclusion. And Native peoples and Mexicans had to and have to deal with conquest. Aristide Zolberg writes that United States immigration and naturalization law is about creating a nation by design. A nation by design. Throughout the immigrant experience, we have seen how workers gain respect with employment. Everyone is committed to work when decently employed. Immigrant workers throughout history are following the logic of where wealth can be redistributed. Unions have always asked for decency in meeting subsistence needs. Every immigrant community that is now part of the American social fabric develops strategies to improve the immigrant community's struggle to survive. A sense of awareness and a commitment to immigrant rights and responsibilities have always been a part of the naturalization process. We've seen it. We started with the red beans. Then we moved to the white beans, then over to the black beans, then to the yellow beans, and then last week the brown beans. There is a rich heritage in America that comes from the immigrant experience. It is known as socialist organizing. When we talk about patriotism, most often the right wing of America claim that they express the American spirit and revere its symbols more than anybody else, while those who criticize the United States government are labeled anti-patriotic. So students, I want you to know that the terms progressive and patriotic are part of the immigrant experience. Let's take the Pledge of Allegiance. It was written in 1892 by a leading Christian socialist, Francis Bellamy. He was fired from his Boston ministry for his sermons depicting Jesus as a socialist. Jesus, a socialist. Students, please understand that Christianity is socialism. I don't know why everybody gets all afraid of this particular word, socialism. Christianity is a challenge to treat all peoples as human beings, especially when redistributing the collection of wealth. That Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, represents the unified presence of humanity. The sacrament, the body of Christ. All churches are built around the physical presence of Christ's socialist commitment. This is what drove Francis Bellamy to write in the Pledge of Allegiance a more collective and egalitarian vision of America. One nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all, for all. So get to know it. Get to know it when you pledge allegiance to this flag. Tell the right-wing radio and television hate mongers about the socialist influence in the Pledge of Allegiance. It was written by a socialist. How about that? Whoa. Furthermore, let's take a look at the Statue of Bigotry. I mean, Statue of Liberty. It's written underneath, "Give me your tired, your poor huddled masses yearning to breathe free," or yearning to be free. If we could put Emma Lazarus. There we go. It was written by Emma Lazarus, a poet of considerable repute in her day. She was a well-known figure in literary circles. She was an avowed socialist. She wrote this welcome in the Statue of Liberty to the wretched of the earth in 1883, and it was done in an effort to project an inclusive and an egalitarian definition of the American dream. Immigrants built this nation. They formed the foundation of this nation. So please appreciate the symbolism of the Statue of Liberty. What the symbol offers is all who come to this nation should be treated equal. Then there's a most famous woman. Her name is Catherine Lee Bates. Catherine Lee Bates was a professor of English at Wellesley College. She was an ardent feminist. She was a lesbian socialist. Oh my goodness. And she wrote America the Beautiful. In the song that so many patriots sing, it reflects this lesbian's view about U.S. imperialism and that U.S. imperialism undermines the nation's core values of freedom and liberty. The song or the poem's final words, "And crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea." This is an appeal for social justice. It's not about the pursuit of wealth. So next time you hear right-wing evangelists sing America the Beautiful, tell them it was written by a radical lesbian feminist. Get to know this. Let's listen to Ray Charles explain the beauty of America.
Oh, beautiful, for heroes proved in liberating strife, myself. Girl, country loved. Something like this. Oh, beautiful, far spacious skies, far amber waves of grain. Majesties. Look here, I'm talking about America, sweet America.
Ray Charles, none other, singing it right. See, what is socialism? Well, first of all, there are no clear-cut blueprints, no cast in concrete constitutional arrangements, and no specific body of ideas and theories on socialism. Socialism is a process of ideas whereby people arrange, design, and construct a just society. And the central goal of socialism is humankind. Socialism places at its center the concept of direct participatory mass democracy and involvement by everyone in the decisions that give direction to the social order. So the aim of socialism is democratization of life in general, not just democratization of politics. Socialism does not call for political democracy, or doesn't call for just political democracy. Socialism adds to that economic democracy. it adds to that social equality. And of course, depending on who is doing the organizing, and into racial discrimination and into gender discrimination. Can you imagine that? So, progressive reform and the socialist tradition are very important for us to appreciate at the turn of the century. Socialists take the position that all persons share certain needs. There exists some minimum requirement of food, of shelter, of health, and so forth, which all people share. No decent society would concentrate wealth in the hands of the few while the needs of the majority go unmet. Society must be organized in such a way that can allow and encourage all human beings to realize their humanness. Human beings, from the socialist view, are purposeful beings who are able, if given a chance, but you got to be given a chance to make decisions intelligently, of people who have intentions and purposes, and of people who can become aware of alternatives and rationally choose amongst them. So you see, people are potentially self-directed. People are potentially self-determining. People are capable of self-expression. People are capable of creativity. But you have to be given the chance. So, equality of condition is the foundation of socialism. This is what the second wave of immigrants brought to this country. The dream of equality. Get to know it. White beings believed in civil rights for all Europeans. Now, I say Europeans because many had their reservations about native peoples. Many had hesitancy about the blackness of Africans. And of course, Mexicanos eat too many frijoles. But nonetheless, this is the great heritage, equality of condition for all. An event worth appreciating concerning the immigrant woman's experience is the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory Fire of 1911. See, industrial growth affected factory workers most directly, especially immigrant women. Working conditions were often dangerous. Family survival required women and children to work, often in the lowest paid, most exploited positions. Women and children worked in poor ventilation, with dangerous fumes, open machinery, no safety precautions, in very unhealthful conditions. Let's appreciate what happened to primarily Jewish immigrant women in New York in 1911 when a fire killed 146 of them trapped inside a factory.
It was late in the afternoon on a beautiful spring Saturday, March 25th, 1911. 4:40 p.m. to be exact, nearly quitting time at the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory in New York's Greenwich Village, where 500 workers, mostly young Italian and Jewish women and girls, got ready to collect their pay and go home. Someone dropped a match or a cigarette, and within minutes, the factory, which occupied the top three floors of a 10-story building, became an inferno. Fire ladders, which reached only six floors, were useless. The fire escape collapsed under the weight of desperate workers trying to escape. One of the doors, it would be reported, was locked. Onlookers out for a weekend stroll in nearby Washington Square Park watched in horror as women leapt to their deaths from upper-story windows, some crashing through the firemen's nets, others hitting the sidewalk with a sickening thud.
It's almost a mirror of what happened in 9/11.
In some ways, it was the horror of the fire jumping the way they did. And it was more intimate, though. You could look into their faces in their last moments, hear them hit the pavement that way, you know.
In the days that followed, family members crowded into a makeshift morgue, trying, sometimes in vain, to identify those they lost among the charred remains. On that day, says researcher Michael Hirsch, all of New York was united in grief.
This fire really shook people up. You know, the city was so guilt-stricken that maybe we were somehow responsible. And it led to all of these reforms that came afterward.
Out of the ashes of the Triangle Fire came new safety and fire regulations, child labor laws, and workmen's compensation. The outpouring of support for working people galvanized the fledgling American labor movement. Frances Perkins, who witnessed the tragedy that awful day and who would go on to become FDR's Secretary of Labor, called it the day the New Deal began. Every year since then, there have been tributes and remembrances, and this year is no exception.
This is the Union Monument to the Triangle victims.
But Michael Hirsch, co-producer of an HBO documentary on the Triangle Fire, worries that memories of that day and its repercussions are fading, like the names on the graves at Mount Zion Cemetery in Queens.
You used to be able to read this, but it's just melting away. And it's almost like a metaphor for the way we're forgetting these people and what they did for us.
For the last 5 years, Hirsch has made it his mission to find the names of all 146 people who died in the fire that day and their stories.
I just felt we owed it to them somehow. They lost everything, and for them to lose their names as well, that just seemed wrong.
I always remember my dad telling us that he had an aunt who died in the fire, but that is all I remember.
Erica Landsner didn't even know her great aunt's name until she got a call from Michael Hirsch.
And he said, could you possibly be related to Fanny Landsner, who died in the Triangle Fire? So this is a picture of Fanny from the newspaper article.
Erica Landsner discovered that her 21-year-old Aunt Fanny was a hero that day, saving the lives of many of her coworkers before jumping to her own death.
And just to think of a 21-year-old knowing she had minutes to live and chose to put others ahead of herself is just extraordinary. I feel actually quite proud, you know, to be her descendant.
Essie Bernstein also died in the fire. She was a relative of factory owner Max Blank, who, along with his partner Isaac Harris, was accused of locking the factory door. Some say to keep out union organizers after a bitter strike. Their acquittal by a jury caused outrage then, and still rankles some today. In truth, though, says Michael Hirsch, the Blank family suffered too.
The Blank family, they lost more people in the Triangle Fire than any other family. No one really knows this. It's just been kept out of the histories of this.
Why?
I think it's just you start to mention things like that, you start to humanize these people and start to tell the story differently.
Susan Harris is the granddaughter of Max Blank. Growing up, she says, she knew nothing of the Triangle Fire. Her family moved to California and changed the spelling of their name. When she was a teenager, she came across a book and a name that looked familiar.
I remember turning to my mom and I said, you know, was this Max Blank? Was this my grandfather? And she said, yes, but that happened a long time ago. You don't need to worry about that.
She has spent the last 5 years remembering the fire and its victims by stitching the names of the dead onto pieces of old shirtwaist fabric and handkerchiefs.
The reason I use the shirtwaist pieces is obvious because of the waste factory. And the reason I used the handkerchiefs was because of the loss and the grief.
She calls them prayer flags.
So many people, mm-hmm. they blame your family. Mm-hmm. For what happened.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. I think that if I had lost, you know, my children in the fire, I would have wanted to blame someone as well.
So many lives cut short that day. So many families broken. So many memories lost and found. And so much pain. But also stories of courage and triumph. And that, says Michael Hirsch, is worth remembering.
They didn't set out to be heroes. They weren't like soldiers on the battlefield. You know, they wanted what we all want. They wanted families. They wanted to have a successful life here. They wanted to be Americans. And their sacrifice is the thing that really motivated people to start thinking about doing things differently in this country. So in a way, they are kind of heroes. I look at them that way.
Fascinating experience. Immigrant workers, immigrant women workers. When Thomas Jefferson came to power in 1800, his administration had abolished what was known as the Alien and Sedition Act of 1798. This act will reappear under the guise of the Espionage Act of 1917 in the Democratic administration of Woodrow Wilson during World War I. The Espionage Act of 1917 forbade the use of disloyal, profane, scurrilous, or abusive language about the United States government, its flag, or its armed forces or speeches that caused others to view the American government or its institutions with contempt. This act also allowed the Postmaster General to refuse to deliver mail that met those same standards for punishable speech or opinion. It applied only to times when, quote unquote, when the United States is in war. The Espionage Act, of which the Alien and Sedition Act came under its purview, made it a crime to aid enemies of the United States or to interfere with the war effort or with military recruitment. The Sedition Act extended its provision to cover a broader range of offenses, notably speech and expression of opinion, that cast the government or the war effort in a negative light or interfered with the sale of government bonds. One historian of American civil liberties has called it the nation's worst extreme anti-speech legislation. And those convicted under the act generally received sentences of imprisonment for 10 to 20 years. The Espionage Act was used to imprison Americans who spoke or wrote against World War I. Historian Howard Zinn notes the Espionage Act, thus approved by the Supreme Court, has remained in the books all these years since World War I, and although it is supposed to apply only in wartime, it has been constantly enforced since 1950 because the United States has legally been in a state of emergency since the Korean War. So in 1918, Wilson and Congress went one step further in identifying immigrants as dangerous subversives. They amended the 1917 Espionage Act to include alien and sedition. So there are two precedents for Americans to use the term alien when referring to immigrants. The term alien is associated with sedition. Hence, to use the term alien indicates the person is identifying people who are not loyal to the United States. So please understand that alien is used in reference to Europeans, not Mexicans or Asians. Europeans acquired the description due to their desire to overthrow existing authority. Now it is applied to Asians and Mexicans. So the term alien indicates the person is using that label to identify people who are not loyal to the United States. To be alien connotes sedition. So loyalty is the catchword. And for us today, this loyalty became emphasized after 9/11. The Patriot Act of 2002 dramatically reduced restrictions on law enforcement agencies' ability to search telephone, email communications, financial, medical, and other records of private citizens. It eased restrictions on foreign intelligence gathering within the United States. It expanded the Secretary of the Treasury's authority to regulate financial transactions, particularly those involving foreign individuals and entities. And it broadened the discretion of law enforcement and immigration authorities in detaining and deporting immigrants suspected of terrorism-related acts. The act also expanded the definition of terrorism to include domestic terrorism, thus enlarging the number of activities to which the USA Patriot Act expanded law enforcement powers could be applied. So what we see today is the right's attempt to squeal about a Mexican immigrant's undocumented status as some terrorist act, sort of a feat of criminal activity. Now, all in all, despite the immigrant's choice to search for an economic existence in this country, when we take a look at the legislative acts implemented by Congress to help us understand the process immigrants have had to go through to become a part of this community known as the United States of America, in almost all of these acts, passage was based on a fear of the other, a fear of the not me, a fear of the stranger at the gate. Let's recognize the fear factor when discussing issues related to immigration. So in this class, students, by the time that we get to the current reform debates, you should have laid the fear aspect down. It should no longer be fearful. The debate should be human, about human beings, about reform. So let's appreciate the Palmer raids. The Palmer raids were attempts by the United States Department of Justice to arrest and deport radical immigrants from the United States. The raids and arrests occurred on November 19th and January 1920 under the leadership of Attorney General A. Mitchell Palmer. Though more than 500 citizens were deported, including a number of prominent leftist leaders such as Alexander Berkman and Emma Goldman, Palmer's efforts were largely frustrated by officials at the U.S. Department of Labor who had responsibility for deportations and who objected to Palmer's methods and disrespect for the legal process. The Palmer raids occurred in the larger context of what was known as the Red Scare, the term given in fear of and reaction against political radicals in the U.S. in the years immediately following World War I. Let's take a look at a film clip that helps us understand these radical white beings.
In the aftermath of the First World War, as the country began to think about what was meant by a, quote, return to normalcy, unquote, part of the agenda was to craft a more comprehensive social control form of immigration and deportation laws. And the laws that were developed in 1917 had both ideological components and criminal enforcement components. And in many ways, that was the first comprehensive, sort of modern type of deportation law that we saw. And it arose out of a lot of loyalty controversies that had taken place during the war, and also confirmed the role of the federal government and the bureaucratized model of deportation enforcement. So it started focusing on criminal aliens as well as focusing on people who were ideologically deemed to be subject to deportation, anarchists and socialists in particular. Those things sort of developed parallel together during that period. And I think the underlying idea was that there are certain people who are just not worthy of being members of American society, and even if they have been admitted legally, we should get rid of them. A lot of the discourse as it develops in the 1920s around these sorts of laws focuses on an alleged crime problem that was largely undertaken by non-citizens. When you actually read more sober studies of the period, you might really question whether there was such a crime wave. And also, you would notice that there were a lot of native-born American citizens who were engaged in criminal activities as well. But the public discourse began to shift, particularly with the rise of J. Edgar Hoover and the early FBI. The focus turned increasingly to deporting non-citizen criminal aliens, particularly those convicted of crimes involving moral turpitude, which was a category that was developed in those early laws, and also people with drug offenses. And so the mechanisms of deportation, the systems became increased, the funding became increased, the bureaucracy became much larger, and we started seeing more people being focused on. This continued into the 30s and the 1940s, and in many ways has continued to the present day.
All right, so this is what we're going to try to appreciate. See, Europeans coming to America since the colonial period already had ideas about non-white racial groups. These beliefs became rigid, and they served as justification for certain actions. The belief that one group is superior to another results in certain actions. So it's important to understand the underlying ideology, as that one professor shared, which on an everyday level justifies these actions. We find the basis for ideologies expressed by the media, by individuals and in literature. Some stereotypes, well, they can be seen as positive. Some are rather contradictory. But really, ideology is a set of interrelated beliefs, of values, of attitudes and norms that are used to explain and justify existing social relations. So ideology forms sort of like a matrix through which people explain behavior. Now, racism is, as an ideology, is not new. Groups have always felt superior to other groups. But modern racism is different because it is the only form of racism that tries to get scientific validity. It is racism with scientific vindication. There have always been philosophies behind racism, but scientific racism has the guise of science. Now, when we think of science, we think of objectivity, the testing of a hypothesis with empirical data, which either proves or disproves the hypothesis. Science, however, does not occur in a vacuum. Scientific racism, which was known as eugenics, and so if you could put nativism and eugenics down, crew, I appreciate it. The scientific racism, which was known as eugenics, arose in the late 19th and early 20th century at a time when people of color were increasingly being exploited. Now, science is done within a social context with cultural ideas, with cultural attitudes. So if one group was believed to be genetically inferior to another, what would happen if there was any racial mixture? This was answered with the logic of different species mating. It was believed that if different races mated, this would result in a sickly race of people. So during the second wave era, eugenics used the guise of science to create evidence of white racial superiority. First through what was known as polygyny, the study of human evolution, and craniometry, the study of human skulls. Scientists tried to prove that whites were smarter than blacks, were smarter than native peoples. And these results had real-world impact, since after the Civil War, politicians became convinced in the separation of the races because scientists believed that race mixture would result in a weakened race. Scientists became more sophisticated in their techniques that by World War I, intelligent quotient exams were created, and scientists claimed from these tests the superiority of whites over blacks over native people. So eugenics justified existing stereotypes, and it gave sustenance to broader policy choices. Now think about it. Let's take a look at the National Origins Act of 1921 and the National Origins Act of 1924. The reason the most controversial acts regarding immigration passed both houses of Congress was related to the turbulent white migration of populations to the United States. And remember, when we talk about alien, we're referring to Europeans, not Asians or Mexicans. The National Origins Act of 1921 and 24 were influenced by the radicalism of white workers who wanted justice. When the 1920s began, the U.S. government made sure that radical white beans would be green beans. The greens go. The white beans were silenced. The IWW was destroyed. All radical immigrants, all white beans who wanted to hang out with black beans and red beans and yellow beans, all those kind of white beans who wanted to hang out with them, no, they're going to jail. And so the main leader of the Socialist Party, Eugene Debs, was in jail. He ran for the presidency from jail and got close to a million votes. Go figure. Strikes by white workers along with the people of color that they were trying to uplift were beaten down by force. Congress in the 20s put an end to the dangerous and turbulent flood of immigration of immigrants by passing laws setting immigration quotas. It's very scientific. The quotas favored Anglo-Saxons. It kept out people from Africa. It kept out people from Asia. It limited the arrival of Southern and Eastern Europeans, of Latins, Slavs, and Jews. And Congress made sure that English, Protestant, Irish, and Germans were favored over African, Chinese, and Eastern Europeans. So the National Origins Act solidified the melting pot theory for white Americans. It ensured a three-generational process of assimilation as defined in the earlier presentation on white beans. Immigration became a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant privilege in the 1920s. And at the same time, the KKK was revived in the 1920s, and it spread into the North. And by 1924, the KKK was boasting that it had 4.5 million members. The warning sign to immigrants coming to America became cemented in the decade known as the Roaring Twenties, the Jazz Age. Only WASPs apply. What we have learned is that when you're in a disadvantaged position, you must organize for your rights. White beans have a history of protecting themselves from harm. It is good to know that white beans want to include black, yellow, red, and brown beans in their midst. So when we take a look at the source of the wealth that was generated at the turn of the century and that was used for the financing of mass consumption and mass production, that was mining. Mexico, with financial backing from Wall Street, tapped into its mineral wealth. The United States, meanwhile, developed the mineral wealth that once belonged to her neighbor to the south. Arizona and New Mexico teemed with activity. Mexicans filled the labor needs for this exploding industry. Let's take a look at a film clip from Los Mineros, a PBS documentary, to get a glimpse at the process of change that occurred in Arizona at the turn of the century. Let's watch a film clip from a PBS documentary entitled Los Mineros. Let's visit a place called Clifton Morenci in Arizona and appreciate how racism is an instrument of power used by those in power to perpetuate their power. Let's also appreciate the racist legacy of Arizona and recognize that the current crisis in Arizona is but a continuous expression of a deep-rooted hatred that whites have exhibited towards Mexicans in that state.
This is a story of men who came to work in a foreign land. A story that has never been told.
Nos traían de México para trabajar las minas de cobre allá en Arizona.
They brought us from Mexico to work the copper mines of Arizona.
Pensando que como humanos nos querían.
We thought they saw us as human beings.
Mas solo querían nuestro sudor y labor.
But they only wanted our sweat and labor.
Pasaron los años 50 lo menos.
For 50 years we fought. And in the end, we triumphed.
Lo que tanto peleamos. Para que no se trataran como seres humanos.
This is the story of the Battle of Los Mineros.
De los mineros.
Clifton Morenci, Arizona. There's little left to remind us of the fortunes that were made and lost in these hills. Copper made this one of the richest mining districts in the United States. Thousands of Mexican workers came here. They were promised jobs and good wages. Among the first to arrive was the father of David Velasquez. He left Mexico with a few bags and a contractor's words of great opportunity still echoing in his head.
My father came over to Morenci in about 1906, and he used to live in Chihuahua. Apparently, the American companies knew that the people from Chihuahua were experienced miners. So they used to send their people out there and recruit. And they come over with what they used to call reenganches. In other words, they recruit a bunch of people, of men especially, and bring them over all together.
Most of the mineros came from the northern Mexican states of Sonora and Chihuahua, where they had been miners for generations. They were brought to a small mining district in eastern Arizona. Within a few years, Clifton Morenci grew from 200 to 10,000. The mining boom was sparked by America's enormous appetite for copper. With the arrival of electricity, copper was needed for telephone lines, telegraph service, and power plants. Newcomers from all over came to work in Morenci. They shared one thing in common: the business of getting copper out of the ground. Using candles for light, the miners spent 12 hours a day underground. They worked 4,000 feet below the surface in a maze of tunnels 100 miles long. The shafts were supported only by wooden beams.
You can always hear the timber creaking, like in an old house. Of course, the first thing you did when you went into your working place was look for loose boulders, loose rocks. And you put in timbers for as much room as you had. And you'd start drilling and just hope nothing fell on you.
Work areas were cramped. The air was thin. Temperatures would rise to 104 degrees. As experienced miners, the mineros were accustomed to harsh conditions underground. What they weren't prepared for was the way they were treated simply because they were Mexican. Sylvester Mowry, an early traveler to Arizona, wrote,
"My own experience has taught me that the lower class of Mexicans are docile, faithful, good servants. They have been peons for generations. It is their natural condition."
Mexicans were assigned the worst jobs in the mines, and the most dangerous. Anglo timbermen who built the wooden supports were paid $4 a day. Mexican timbermen received $2. Anglo muckers who shoveled the ore out of the mines were paid $1.50 a day. Mexican muckers were paid 70 cents. This dual wage system persisted throughout the mining industry.
Nos trajeron porque podemos trabajar.
They brought us for our skills, and now they treat us worse than dogs.
Porque no somos como ellos.
Because we are not like them, they forget we are men.
In those days, a lot of them suffered. They were the burros, the ones that did all the work in those mines. See what I mean? Those were the guys that were producing and dying in there.
The minero not only faced hardship in the mines, but also in town, a company town built chiefly by the Phelps Dodge Corporation. Like all such towns, the company owned and operated everything, from the waterworks to the hospital to the workers' homes. Miners bought their food and dry goods at the Phelps Dodge Mercantile Store, where markups of 200% were common. With a day's salary, a miner could only buy a dozen eggs and a pound of coffee.
It was hard on my father because he didn't know how to speak English. He didn't know how to add or subtract. I saw receipts from the grocery store where they would add them up. They didn't have an adding machine at that time, but add them up by hand. 6 and 6, 15. One and carry the 5. Always to the store advantage.
The Morenci Club was where company officials and their families spent their free time. Here they could play billiards, tennis, and bridge. The club was off limits to Mexicans, as were all Anglo establishments. Socializing between Anglos and Mexicans was strictly forbidden.
This one morning when I went to work, told me the mine superintendent wanted to see me. So I went over and he said, Avery, you had so-and-so up at your house last night. And I said, yeah. He said, you don't have Mexicans come to your house. And I said, well, goddamn, it's my house. I'll have anybody come to it I want. He said, no, that's company house. And he said, you work for the company. Remember that.
That's a great deal. All right, so we can appreciate something about, again, the four-part process that the community faced: racism and social discrimination, educational deprivation, political disfranchisement, and economic marginality through a dual wage system. Yet Mexican labor was needed. There are some comments that students are making. Indira, thank you, Indira, for participating in class. The 1918 Alien and Sedition Act was why Emma Goldman was deported. She was a radical that spoke out against World War I. Yes, Indira, yes, that's one of the reasons why she will be deported, because she did not believe in war. And as an immigrant woman, she was earmarked. Cynthia, you have a comment, Cynthia. Thank you, Cynthia, for participating. Cynthia, I was thinking that interracial marriage and breeding would result in a strengthening of the human race. Constant inbreeding creates genetic defects. Well, yes. Okay, Cynthia, thank you very much. I appreciate your contribution there. Yes, it's nice to interbreed. Thank you. Now, please understand that labor organizing and the socialist tradition in both Mexico and the United States between 1880 and 1920 was pervasive. Their movements for change reflect the people's commitment to creating a just society. They are the reason why we must pay attention to social change and the development of consciousness. There is a strong socialist tradition in both countries. It's just that, in the discourse, what happened in the 1980s and 1990s is that the far right decided to call the center socialist. The center has nothing to do with socialism. In fact, they're calling liberals as socialists. That's why those people who put Obama as a socialist, Obama's not even a socialist. Obama has no idea of what socialism means. People understood that socialism is a process of ideas where people arrange, design, and construct a just society. The central goal of socialism is humankind. People undergoing populism and progressive reform in the United States between 1880 and 1920, through farmers' associations, through labor organizations, through women's rights movements, and people undergoing revolution in Mexico to radically reconstruct a constitution that gave meaningful voice to the equal distribution of wealth and the end to racial and gender discrimination in Mexico, all of them placed at their respective movement center a concept of direct participatory mass democracy and involvement by everyone in the decisions that direct the social order. People call not just for political democracy, the right to vote, but also economic democracy, the right to a living wage, to social equality, the right to be free in your expression of culture, and an end to racial and gender discrimination. Let's return to the documentary on Los Mineros and witness how Mexicans formed mutual aid societies and attempted to be recognized as unions in an effort to end the dual wage system in a 1903 strike at Clifton Morenci. Please listen to how white miners disdained their Mexican counterparts.
Mexicans were forced to live in the most undesirable parts of town, usually along steep hillsides. In Morenci, the Mexican side of town was called Chihuahua Hill. Unlike Anglo neighborhoods, Mexican homes had no electricity or running water. Most houses were made from scrap wood supplied by the company.
In the hill where we used to live, they call it Chihuahuita, because there was a lot of people from Chihuahua. Most of those people had to build their own shacks. Just get 1x12s, put them together, make a room, and
a roof and cover them with a muslin. A lot of people, all they had was those powder boxes, you know, wooden powder boxes they used as chairs. I remember that a lot of times we see people moving from one house to the other, you know. And they always did it at night. And one time I asked my mother, she says, how come they always do it at night? Why don't they do it in the daytime? He said, well, he says their furniture is so bad that they want to move at night when people won't see what they have.
A sense of community developed in Chihuahuita. Shut out by the Anglos, the Mineros started societies of their own, called mutualistas, or mutual aid societies.
Mutualistas were very important for Mexicans to combat racism. The Alianza Hispanoamericana, or La Liga Protectora, made it very clear that they were there to protect the rights of Mexicans, to speak out for the Mexican, to help them in any way that they could.
The Mutualistas offered burial insurance and sponsored social events, and increasingly tried to deal with a hostile Anglo world. A report from the Department of Interior in 1908 stated,
the Mexican laborer is unambitious, listless, physically weak, irregular, and indolent. His strongest point is his willingness to work for low wages.
As the mine owners aggressively recruited Mexican labor, Anglo workers were terrified their own jobs were in jeopardy because Mexicans worked for so little. The Anglos turned to a union, the Western Federation of Miners. The WFM decided the best way to protect Anglos was to drive the Mexicans out of the mines. The anti-Mexican campaign began with a devious plan. Anglos were paid by the day, the Mexicans by the hour. The union forced the copper companies to cut the workday from 10 hours to 8 hours. Overnight, the mineros suffered a 20% cut in pay. On the morning of June 3, 1903, for the first time in Arizona history, over 1,000 Mexican workers went out on strike. The mining companies refused to negotiate. Abraham Salcido, a 26-year-old minero from Chihuahua, led the strike against the company, becoming a folk hero in the process.
Estos versos que yo canto se convierten en corrido.
The verses that I sing is a corrido to remember a hero whose name is Abraham Salcido.
Abraham Salcido vino a Clifton, Arizona.
He came to Clifton, Arizona,
a ayudarle a sus paisanos,
to help his countrymen earn an equal wage like the Americans.
Sueldo como los americanos.
The mineros armed themselves and took control of the mines, shutting down the smelters and mills. The governor asked the Mexican consul to come talk some sense to the Mexicans and ordered 300 Arizona Rangers to the scene. Two 2,000 miners marched in solidarity through the town, openly taunting the Rangers. The governor cabled President Roosevelt asking for cavalry support.
Comenzaron la discordia, les llegó una tempestad.
At the height of the tension, a heavy thunderstorm broke. A massive flood swept over the city.
When the flood hit the Mexican side of town, 50 people were killed instantly. Most of their homes were destroyed. The next day, federal troops disarmed the strikers and placed the community under martial law. 10 of the strike leaders were arrested, including Abraham Salcido. He was sentenced to 3 years in prison for inciting a riot. Within 2 weeks, the strikers were back at work. The strike had failed. The dual wage system was still in place. The mineros had lost the opening skirmish, but the battle was far from over.
Fascinating. Again, students, you had the option of viewing this particular documentary. It's available to you in its entirety. There is a comment by Hakim. Hakim, thank you very much for participating. It's interesting to hear about the acts you speak of and how it seems to continue today. And I guess you're referring to the quota acts of 1921 and 1924. Tests which were developed for things such as jobs, education, were geared in favor of the majority whites. Racism was not only driven by hate, but also planned as a scientific revelation. Society begins to agree with the ideal of white superiority, which still continues. I guess that was your comment then, Hakim. Yes, it's interesting how we still have those kinds of debates today with regards to superiority and the immigration. And I'm sure the immigration reform debate is going to bring in all of these issues. Thank you, Hakim, for that comment. Just south of Clifton Morenci, there occurred a major battle involving a transnational corporation practicing a dual wage system. Only this time, the dual wage system favored American immigrant workers over Mexican citizens. In an isolated spot bordering southeastern Arizona and northeastern Sonora, during June 1906, a strike took place in the Mexican mining town of Cananea, Sonora. And since the late 19th century, the Nogales-based Cananea Consolidated Copper Company paid over 5,000 Mexican workers half the wages per day that over 2,000 American immigrant workers were earning for the same job. And conditions in which the Mexican employees worked were deplorable. So during a celebration of Cinco de Mayo, the Mexican employees made public their complaints while the local authority applied martial law to avoid further conflicts. Striking workers in Cananea confronted U.S. soldiers protecting the company store. Let's return to the documentary on Los Mineros and witness an effort to end the dual wage system in Cananea, Mexico, under the Porfirio Diaz regime. Let's appreciate Abraham Salcido. One of the reasons Mexicans sing corridos is to honor those who help us remember a moment of resistance against oppression. That's what the corrido is all about. Corridos retell a story of what was once lived. That's the history. Corridos are popular cultural expressions recounting heroic struggles to achieve justice against institutionalized racism. How else can you make sense of Cananea in 1906 if it isn't through the corrido of Abraham Salcido? After 3 years in an Arizona prison for the Clifton Morenci strike in 1903, he's going to get out of jail and he's going to go directly to the Cananea and start a strike there. He will be found in the organizational struggle of Mexican workers known as the Cananea strike. Let's go to the Cananea strike.
Every day, people was getting hurt underground mining. A lot of times, people will blow up working with the dynamite. And sometimes, the tunnels where they're working will cave in. Almost every day, they used to bring out somebody with a broken leg, broken arm, broken something, neck or something like that. Every day used to happen that.
A lot of them got caught by those motor cars they had in there that pulled those little old cars. Sometimes it was pretty dark in there, you know, with the dust and fumes in there, and these guys couldn't see those motor cars coming, and I saw a lot of them die.
There was not too much protection for the workers. They did most of the drilling dry. They didn't have respirators. The only thing they could do was cover their face with a handkerchief.
Among the worst threats miners faced was silicosis, known as miner's consumption. One out of every three miners got this deadly lung condition from years of breathing the mineral dust.
My father, after putting about 22 years underground, he could barely breathe.
He coughs day and night because his lungs are full of that dust, you know. Can't get it out of there no more. They cough day and night, and every time they cough, they throw out small pieces of lungs until their lungs disappear and they die. It's painful.
I remember when my father died, we took him by a horse buggy from here down to the depot. Any worker that died, that worked for the company at that time, the company would furnish the train. They would take him by train to the cemetery. And they used to call it the Catholic cemetery because all the Chicanos were Catholics. They wouldn't want to call it the Mexican cemetery, so they just call it the Catholic cemetery.
South of the U.S. border was a mining empire in Cananea, Mexico. An American, Colonel William Green, owned the Cananea Copper Company. Mexican President Porfirio Diaz had enticed foreign industrialists to take advantage of Mexico's rich natural resources. By 1906, Cananea looked more like a company town in Arizona than a Mexican pueblo. The town's most prominent structure was not the Catholic Church, but Colonel Green's two-story clapboard mansion. The mineros suffered the same conditions as their countrymen north of the border. They endured segregated housing, lack of promotion, and even in Mexico, a dual-wage system.
The Americans were paid the number three, in dollars, and the Mexicans were paid 3 pesos. The rate of exchange was 2 to 1, so automatically Americans for the same type of work got paid twice as much.
Outraged by this oppressive treatment of their fellow countrymen, Mexican intellectuals and political activists began to organize. Cananea became a symbol of foreign tyranny.
Señores mineros, teach the American you are not beasts of burden. The American who has displaced us with his legion of blue-eyed blondes, Esteban Calderon.
My father was a baker, and he owned a bakery there in Cananea. But yet he was one of those liberal types, and I guess he liked to play politics. He would sympathize with the miners of the conditions that they were subject. So over here, there was a little place called Ori Plata, where they used to plan their tragedies.
Abraham Salcido was released from prison in Arizona in the spring of 1906. He went directly to Cananea to join the labor organizers working in the mines. On June 2nd, that same year, the mineros went out on strike. They gathered to present their demands to company officials.
Colonel Green personally came out and talked to the miners and told them that he wanted to raise their salaries, but that the president of Mexico wouldn't allow it, that he was asking them as a friend to go back to work.
The strikers refused. Dressed in their Sunday best, they marched through the camp to gather supporters. Over 2,500 arrived at the company's lumber yard, run by two Americans, George and Will Metcalf. George had been warned the strikers were coming.
The first thing that the two Metcalf brothers did inside of the lumberyard was to turn on the hoses that they had in case of a fire, and they trained it on the crowd. This infuriated the miners, so they forced the doors open the two Metcalf brothers shot, apparently first into the air and then directly into the crowd, killing two or three of the miners. The miners set fire to the office of the lumberyard to smoke the two Metcalf brothers out. They came out still shooting, and the miners killed them both. One of them was apparently killed with his own rifle, and the other one was clubbed to death and stuck to death with miners' candlesticks that they were still carrying during the march that they had. Once they had killed the two Metcalf brothers, the miners were met by a group of about 30 armed Americans headed by Green, and the shooting began again.
By 4 o'clock that afternoon, Mexican troops arrived to put down the strike. They were joined by 270 Arizona Rangers who had been armed at the Phelps Dodge Mercantile Store. The Rangers had violated Mexican law in crossing the border with arms. To avoid an international incident, they were hastily deputized by the Mexican state governor. By the next day, the strike had been put down. Once again, Abraham Salcido and the other strike leaders were jailed for inciting a riot.
My father was arrested and sent to prison. They never could prove anything. So he came to the United States and he says, I've had enough of all that thing in Mexico.
23 people lost their lives at Cananea, 17 of them Mexican. The strike had failed. None of the strikers' demands was met. But the Cananea strike would give birth to the first major revolution of the 20th century, the Mexican Revolution. In the end, Porfirio Diaz would be in exile, and 1 million of his countrymen would lay dead. The violence of the Mexican Revolution would have a lasting impact on the border region. Volatile racial tensions were inflamed. Arizonans feared the bloodshed would spill over the border.
Okay, fascinating. Now, although the workers were forced to return to their positions with no demands being met, the action was a key event in the general unrest that emerged during the following years of the regime of President Porfirio Diaz, and that prefigured the Mexican Revolution of 1910. Again, the racism of Arizona is expressed as armed rangers cross the border into Mexico to attack Mexicans. Go figure how the Mexican government deputized them. And if you can figure that out, then you can recognize something about the chaos that led to the Mexican Revolution. Some students have some comments. Yesenia, instead of pushing out the Mexicans, why didn't the Anglos think outside the box and unite with the Mexicans to have the same wages? They wouldn't be fighting against each other. Well, Yesenia, you have some nice ideas, but Yesenia, you have read already, hopefully, the first part of Gonzalez's Harvest of Empire, so that you can understand and appreciate why those kinds of things would not have happened. But thank you, Yesenia, for participating in the class, and thank you for bringing that topic up. Is there another comment, or is that it? Okay. So, despite the chaos, you know, despite all of these experiences, you know, the community, remember what I shared with you, that acute disillusionment can rob life of its meaning. So the community has to stay together. The community must, they have to tolerate the experiences. So they find ways from within by which to celebrate their heritage, to celebrate their identity through their culture, through music, through dance and food preparation. Let's go back to the Minero struggle and appreciate how they celebrated.
To survive in this hostile environment, the Mineros turned inward, looking to each other for help and support. Strong ties of language and culture kept them united. On Mexican holidays, everyone in Chihuahuita turned out to celebrate.
They used to have a town band, and they used to have concerts at the plaza, you know, had a little kiosco, you know, the gazebo, I think they call it. And it was something like a family day. The big fiesta was on the 16th of September, Cinco de Mayo. They used to have games and contests and races and boxing matches. They used to have what they called charrascas, which was house parties. They had a regular orchestra, you know, violin, guitar, and maybe a bass.
We used to have good orchestra.
Very good music. Besos y cerezas. You never heard that, did you?
I had to bake two pies or three pies every Saturday or two, three cakes every Saturday so I could go to the dance.
And of course, they always had a tub full of ice and beer. It was, used to be homebrew. We kids used to go there and stand out on the porch and look inside, look at the grown-ups dancing and kicking up quite a storm.
They were really dancers. We wear long dresses.
What you're talking about
long is dresses.
Ooh, we used to dance the floor with that one.
All right, just dance the floor with those rancheritas. All right, so as Mexicans in Arizona adjusted to the racialization process, they organized community celebrations respecting their heritage. So music, food, dance, they were created for their delight. Then struggles appeared. Carlos, you had a comment. What are the green beans representing? Well, remember, the green beans are the ones that get deported. The green beans are the ones that are not wanted. So maybe I should put those up here because we are dealing with immigration restriction legislation and not having those green beans participate with everyone else. But thanks for bringing that up, Carlos. I'll bring out the green beans here. But if all of you remember, let's go to what is known as the Bisbee deportation. Now, if all of you remember the great socialist tradition of the European immigrant worker, then most of you can appreciate how that tradition found fruition in the organizing efforts of one of the most important labor unions of the early 20th century. That was the Industrial Workers of the World, the IWW, the Wobblies. Let's visit a place called Bisbee, Arizona, and let's understand what happened when white workers attempted to unite with Mexicans workers during World War I with the hope of creating racial equality, with the hope of eliminating the dual wage system. Let's appreciate what came to be known as the Bisbee deportation. And let's not be surprised at what Arizona is attempting to do today.
By 1915, a new union had entered Arizona. The International Workers of the World, better known as the Wobblies, were motivated by socialist ideals and dedicated to the overthrow of capitalism.
The IWW was looked upon as being a radical movement made up of unpatriotic Americans who were suspect of having communistic tendencies. The IWW wanted to represent the working class. The IWW wanted to represent the immigrant. And the IWW especially wanted to represent the Mexican immigrant.
The demand was that everyone be treated equally on the job. The men of the union were demanding that they be recognized and there be no discrimination against anyone because of race, religion, or national origin.
World War I brought the Mineros, the Wobblies, and the mining companies into a sharp confrontation. With the country at war, the demand for copper rose astronomically. In 2 years, the price of copper had jumped from 13 cents to 27 cents a pound. By 1917, Phelps Dodge reported a 218% increase in net profits. The workers saw none of this in their paychecks. On June 27, 1917, in nearby Bisbee, 4,000 workers demanded higher wages and an end to the dual wage system. Bolstered by the support of large numbers of mineros, the Wobblies called a strike, war or no war. Walter Douglas, president of Phelps Dodge, had no patience for the demands.
Those who are not for us are against us. The strikers are getting further and further outside the citizens of this country who place devotion to flag above every other consideration. An infected sore may well become a cancer if it is not cut out. Walter Douglas.
Phelps Dodge quickly retaliated.
They put the story out that the miners tunneled underground, that they were German spies, and they were going to blow up the Bisbee post office. The mining company took over the telephone company, the Western Union. They put guards on all incoming and outgoing traffic. You could not come into Bisbee and you could not get word out without mining company permission.
Early on the morning of July 12, 1917, vigilantes armed by Phelps Dodge arrested 2,000 strikers. At gunpoint, the prisoners were marched into the downtown plaza. Those who pledged loyalty to the company were released. Everyone else was marched to the edge of town.
My father was operating a jitney service. That was a long-distance taxi and a local taxi, too. His customers, I assume, would have been mostly the miners. When they started running the people out of town, they came and got him early in the morning.
Prisoners were loaded into cattle cars of the El Paso and Southwestern Railroad, owned by Phelps Dodge. Packed 50 to a car, they were taken 200 miles to Columbus, New Mexico. They were dumped in the desert with no food or water and threatened with death if they returned to Bisbee. Phelps Dodge announced, "Any talk of their coming back is nonsense. They will not be allowed to come back. The serious business of this district is the mining of copper ore, not the building of nightly schools of anarchism." A year later, a commission appointed by President Woodrow Wilson condemned the Bisbee deportation as it came to be known. It was called a grave violation of the law and the Constitution. Unions would not return to Arizona for 25 years.
Well, all you got to do is get the public stirred up, and freedom is out the window. What is it? Eternal vigilance is the price of liberty. And if you're not eternally vigilant, you're going to lose your liberty. And the Mexicans didn't have any to begin with, and the rest of them didn't have much more, as a matter of fact.
Phelps Dodge was growing increasingly powerful. The company bought all of Arizona's leading newspapers. Telephone and telegraph systems were company controlled. Even town attitudes were dominated by the company.
A lot of the Anglos that were in high positions would take advantage of a lot of the Chicanos by pointing the finger at them or trying to make them feel inferior.
Okay, hold on to that because we want to finish out that thought. You see, we talk about civil liberties In this particular case, it was eliminated. The civil liberties were eliminated for war profiteering. Because all you have to do is, like that one labor lawyer said, and it's one of the reasons why that particular man at the very end, when he said, that Mexicans didn't have much rights and the rest not much more, it is because of him that we know of the Bisbee deportation. Get the public stirred up and freedom is out the window. I mean, how many times, as some of you have been mentioning, have we experienced that these past 10 years? Eternal vigilance is the price of liberty. Veronica Alvarez, you share that the Mexicans are the labor force then and now. That's right, Veronica. They've been part of the labor forces from the very beginning. This border is something else. Monda Silva, so would the Cananea strike of 1906 be the foreshadowing of current multinational corporations who's used economic influence as their American ranger? I'm not so sure I understand what you're sharing. Yes, they use actually the laws by which they can implement laws that will help them and assist them in making profits and generating profits. But in one sense, Monda, what you're addressing, and thank you very much for trying to make the connection, is that we'll see, similar cycles of change. You know, history is cyclical. History doesn't repeat itself, but we live in cycles, and we can see these cycles. So we'll see common patterns through every generation. And yes, the modern corporations still follow similar patterns. So if you are not vigilant, you will lose your liberty. And the Mexicans didn't have any, and the rest not much more. At gunpoint, Mexicans were sent across the border at Columbus. And it took a while for those white workers who were also deported, it took a while for them to be processed back to the Appalachian Mountain states where they had originally come from. And it was Buffalo soldiers who were recruited from El Paso, Texas. They were recruited, and the Buffalo soldiers built a tent city for these white workers, and they cooked for them while they were being processed and sent back home. Now, that is an amazing story, and it is straight out of Arizona's racist legacy. We should not be surprised. Let's revisit the National Origins Act of 1924. Now, the reason the most controversial act concerning immigration passed both houses of Congress was related to the turbulent white migration of populations to the United States. Now, please remember that alien refers to Europeans, not Asians or Mexicans. The National Origins Act of 1924 was influenced into law by the radicalism of white workers. So when the 1920s began, the U.S. government made sure the IWW was destroyed, all radical immigrants deported, and the main leader of the Socialist Party was in jail. Strikes by workers were beaten down by force. So Congress in the 20s put an end to the dangerous and turbulent flood of immigrants by passing laws setting immigration quotas. And the quotas favored Anglo-Saxons, it kept out black and yellow people, it limited the arrival of Latinos, of Slavs and Jews, of Latin Slavs and Jews. So, guess what? The Immigration Origins Act did not include Mexicans. What? What are you saying, Fraga? Yeah, it didn't include Mexicans. Because there were significant and powerful industrial and agricultural lobbyists who made sure that Mexicans could come anytime. The compromise was that they would have to pay a head tax to enter, thereby financing the creation of the Border Patrol. Mexicans were wanted and recruited to build the infrastructure of the Southwest. So every time you travel on Interstate 10, get to understand there's the transportation, there's the mining industry, there's the agricultural industry, and all of the irrigation projects. You know, the ones that brought the dam system here, the irrigation projects. They needed Mexican labor. So U.S. corporations optimized their power in Congress in the 1920s, and labor forces are tied to U.S. interests, which necessitates movements of populations for the development of the United States Southwest and Midwest. Railroads, agriculture, mining, irrigation projects assured and perpetuated the need for Mexican labor. So throughout the first two decades of the 20th century, Mexicanos are going to move into areas that are predominantly Mexican and to regions that are environmentally, geographically, and topographically similar to Mexico. As their numbers grew, the treatment of the dominant society became heightened and alarmist. Hysteria surrounds the American communities, especially when numbers of perceived foreigners increase. and the mass media can stir up public opinion, which can influence legislation. So throughout the 20s, the 1920s, debates occurred over what to do with the Mexican. And so it's since the 1850s and increasingly around the turn of the century, urban barrios became important centers of economic, political, and cultural activities. So the urban barrio context is going to be dramatized in the 1920s and 30s as sociologists become concerned in the 1920s with, quote unquote, the Mexican problem. The national legislation of the 1920s and 30s reflected a tug of war between corporations needing labor forces and restrictionist right-wing evangelical bigots known as eugenicists calling for deportation. This is what led to the creation of the Border Patrol under the Immigration Quotas Act of 1924. Mexicans were not included in the act, but now they had to pay a head tax to enter. So throughout the 1920s, eugenicists kept lobbying Congress to extend restriction legislation to Mexicans, but they couldn't mount enough backing to push a bill curbing Mexican immigration. The power of agribusiness and other industrialists employing Mexicans blocked them. Representative James Nance Garner of Texas comforted the racists by informing them that Mexicans returned home after the picking seasons. In his words, all they want is a month's labor in the United States. And that is enough to support them in Mexico for 6 months. They are a docile people. They can be imposed on. The sheriff can go out and make them do anything. So by the eve of the Great Depression, the Mexican Chicanos' economic and political situation worsened. New arguments are going to be advanced by the eugenicists. Widespread unemployment, the racial undesirability of the Mexican, his un-Americanism. In fact, a Dr. Roy L. Garris of Vanderbilt University, an authority on eugenics, testified before Congress claiming science can prove Mexicans' inferiority. He sent his graduate students to research and report on all major Mexican communities in the United States, from San Antonio to Los Angeles, from Denver to Chicago, and to Detroit. And their dissertations on the Mexican communities became evidence at congressional hearings. Here is what one PhD candidate wrote about my grandfather's community in El Paso, Texas. He earned his doctorate writing the following about my dad's neighborhood known as Segundo Barrio. And this is what he wrote. Their minds run to nothing higher than animal functions, eat, sleep, and sexual debauchery. In every huddle of Mexican shacks, one meets the same idleness, hordes of hungry dogs and filthy children with faces plastered with flies, disease, lice, human filth, stench, promiscuous fornication, bastardly, lounging, apathetic peons and lazy squaws, beans and dried chile, liquor, general squalor, and envy and hatred of the gringo. Yet there are Americans clamoring for more of this swine to be brought over from Mexico. Hey, great science, don't you think? Fantastic science. No? The restrictionists won their battle as the Send the Mexican Back to Mexico movement inspired President Herbert Hoover. It was foreigners who were responsible for the Depression. It was foreigners who were responsible for unemployment. It was foreigners who had un-American activities. So the favorite scapegoat of the Depression was the presence of undocumented workers in the United States. Mexicans were the first to be blamed for America's ills. Hoover's Secretary of Labor, William Doak, requested funds for the expansion of the Border Patrol and encouraged local authorities throughout the Southwest and Midwest to devise programs for the deportation of Mexicans. Los Angeles served as a repatriating model. So students, we can't go back to the film on racism and understand and appreciate where we left off on the film, but go back there and understand what happened to the community in Arizona as they have to face the repatriation movement. So let's remember the national character and its attitudes towards Mexicans. It is not just Arizona, but the entire country of black, yellow, red, and white beans in this era that viewed Mexicans, the brown beans, as problematic. The pattern of immigration history reveals the cycles of change that will continue to the present day. whenever there are economic labor necessities in the United States, the remedy becomes Mexican migration, which stimulates a movement of people to the United States. When the labor needs are satisfied, there oftentimes occurs an economic downturn, which results in immigration restriction and deportation. And this process occurs again when the United States is in need of labor. It is important to understand this cycle because it occurs numerous times in the 20th century. It is occurring now. Today's controversy is but a reflection of this historical cycle. It is not anything new, but is an experience for every generation. Every Mexican, from my grandparents to my parents to me, to those children that are coming, have had to deal with this problem of the Mexican and what the United States needs to do with the Mexican. Every generation has had to face it, and Mexicans have to face it today. What's going on? What is going to be going on in the halls of Congress as they're going to be talking about immigration reform? What kind of reform? Now, next week, students, I'm going to be putting up a film because you're going to be reading the book on, or you should be reading the book already, on the Bracero program, a classic program, okay? So you should be reading that, and what I want you to do is watch a film on the Bracero program, because we're going to have the filmmaker come and visit us. It's Dr. Vivian Price. She's a fantastic person, and I really want all of you to watch the film, get the book out of the way, so that next week we can really make her feel comfortable and we can interact with her and get as much as we can. So there's just a few minutes left, and let me just get on the last students that are commenting. Sherry Whitehead, thank you, Sherry, for participating. What did the Bisbee authorities do to keep any potential strikers out of the town? They deported them, Sherry. They just got rid of everyone. They asked for loyalty pledges. That's how they did it. Daphne, anytime things get stirred up, there are going to be casualties, but in the long run, more times than not, change occurs. Well, Daphne, I'm glad that you're positive about that experience, because one of the things that's most important is that people, you know, when people have had enough, they're going to do something by which to change the situation. So yes, those are very important. And then Tamara, thank you, Tamara, for participating. Are we going through deporting Mexicans in Arizona? It seems nothing has changed. Well, again, Tamara, what I want you to emphasize and understand are the cycles of change that I just shared with you. That whenever there are economic labor necessity in the United States, the remedy becomes migration. When those labor needs are satisfied, the remedy becomes deportation. We're going to see those cycles. Thank you very much. We'll see you next week.